So what's the grade cutoff? I don't think it cuts. And it's a year.
All right, everyone, do you think we can start? I have initial very small note, very, very unfortunately, pizza will arrive 15 minutes later. We'll make sure it will come like before everything gets really hyped and everyone is like fully immersed in into this and forgetting even that they have hunger or anything else. So my name is Sarah Nuj. I am a co-founder and co-director of Zapiens, MIT's first human enhancement brain machine interface initiative. And we have the absolute honor and we're very, very happy to have today Dablina. Dablina Sharkar will start as an assistant professor at MIT Media Lab in 2019. She's currently an MIT Transitional Fellow and NIH Postdoctoral Fellow. Her work has led to more than 40 publications to date, over 2,500 citations. Some of her work has also appeared in popular press worldwide. And her PhD dissertation was honored as one of the top three dissertations throughout USA and Canada in the field of mathematics, physics, and all the departments of engineering by the Council of Graduate Schools. And Dablina was awarded US Presidential Awards Outstanding Doctoral Candidate Fellowship, one of the three researchers worldwide to win the prestigious IEEE EDS PhD Fellowship Award, as well as numerous additional honors, being invited to a number of talks, including all the TED Talks that you can imagine.
Take a break.
I have personal honor to work alongside with Dablina for the past 2 years and being supervised for my Super Europe by her during this year, and I'm very excited to share to bring this opportunity so she can share with you what she's planning to do in her lab, and she will announce the rest. Thank you so
much. Okay, thanks a lot. Okay, everyone, so it's very exciting to be here today, and thanks to you all for coming here in this cold, rainy evening. So just to get a feeling of the audience here, so how many of you are undergraduate students here? Okay, quite a few. And how about master's and PhD students? Okay, almost equal number. And postdocs? Okay. Okay, and how about if I divide by departments, from electrical engineering departments? Okay, from bio-related departments, bioengineering, HST, material science, I know one, she's not crazy. Oh, no one from material science except her. And chemical engineering, mechanical. Okay, any other departments I missed?
Aerospace.
Oh, aerospace, oh great. Media lab, of course. Okay, so as Sharon has just mentioned, I'm going to start as an assistant professor in Media Lab in fall 2019. And I'll direct this group called Nano-Cybernetic Biotrek. So what I'm going to do today is give an overview of my past and current research. So right now I'm a postdoctoral researcher in synthetic neurobiology, and my work is developing technologies for understanding the brain. But my background is more as an electrical engineer in nanoelectronics. And so today what I'll do is basically give an overview of my journey from being an electronics engineer to a neurotechnologist. And I'll also tell you what my group will do basically by fusing these two fields. So to get started, I always start with this. So all of you must have noticed how your laptop heats up after you work for some time. And the heat generated is so high that a while ago I even cooked an egg on my laptop. So let us understand where this heat is coming from. So your laptop has a billion switches in it, and in the switches, the electrons need to jump over an energy barrier to cause current flow. So when this barrier is high, very few electrons go from source to the drain, and the switch is off. And when you want to turn on the switches, you apply a voltage to another terminal called gate, and you reduce the barrier height, then more electrons can go from source to the drain, and the switch, or what you call the electronic transistor, turns on. So what we would want in an ideal transistor, that this transition from off to on state is very steep, so that by applying a very small supply voltage, you can get a high change in current. However, you don't live in an ideal world. And in an actual transistor, what happens is that current increases gradually with supply voltage. So you need to apply a finite amount of supply voltage if you want a sizable ratio of on to off currents. And this slope, if you take the inverse of this slope of current versus voltage, that's a parameter called the subthreshold swing. So to easily define what subthreshold swing is, it defines the voltage required to increase the current by tenfold. So you can understand that we are looking for, our aim is to get smaller and smaller subthreshold swing, because smaller subthreshold swing means it will be very steep turnaround characteristics. So with very small supply voltage, that means expending lower power, you can turn on the device. So let us understand what is the problem that we are facing nowadays. So we want to make our transistors smaller and smaller, because smaller transistors means you can fit in more and more in this transistor in a particular area, so you can increase the functionality of your electronics chip, right? However, when you make this transistor smaller in length, what happens is that this energy barrier gets degraded. So you can see the blue line kind of shows the energy barrier for a long channel transistor, and the green line shows for a short channel transistor. When you make the channel shorter, what happens is that the electric field from the drain kind of encroaches into the channel region, and it reduces the barrier height on the source side. So the transistor kind of begins to let current in even when it is supposed to be off. So there's a leakage current that flows in. And you can see that for this short channel transistor, the subthreshold swing or this slope is degraded compared to the long channel transistor. So the off-state current here is higher, off-state leakage, off-state power increases. So in electronics, you can take a rule of thumb is that thinner you make the channel, smaller it can also be in its length. So you can calculate the electrostatics and you find that. So we want to go for thinner and thinner channels. So in this respect, two-dimensional materials are very interesting. So two-dimensional materials are basically materials which comes in layers. So each layer can be only a few atoms thick. So while three-dimensional materials, you can think like potatoes, when you have to cut it to make it thin slices. However, two-dimensional materials, you can think of them like onions. So they already come in layers, so you can peel them off layer by layer. And when you cut potatoes, of course, you see that there's a rough surface. While when you peel off onion, the surface is smooth. Similarly, for three-dimensional materials, when you try to make very thin slices, there would be variation on the surface. That leads to performance variation. However, in 2D materials, they have very smooth surface, so you can get rid of those variations. Moreover, in 3D materials, when you cut the surfaces, there are dangling bonds that are present. 2D materials have relatively pristine interfaces, so gives rise to better electrostatics. So when you think of 2D materials, the first material that comes to your mind is graphene, because graphene is the most widely known 2D material. However, graphene does not have a characteristics which is very interesting, very important for making switches, which is the band gap. So band gap is basically a region forbidden in energy which cannot hold electrons. And to understand very simply, so I told about the energy barrier in a transistor. This energy barrier is provided by the band gap. However, graphene does not have a band gap, so it cannot really distinguish between this off and on state very well. So current will just keep on leaking through this device if you make it with graphene. So that means we need ultra-thin materials, 2D materials, but also which have band gap. And one such material are the transition metal dichalcogenides. So just like graphene, they are also layered, so you can peel them off layer by layer. And within each layer, transition metals are covalently bonded with chalcogenides. But between two layers, there's weak van der Waals bond. So between two layers, there is no covalent bonding. So they can be taken off easily. And again, each layer of these materials are only can be a few atoms thick. So only point, for example, for molybdenum disulfide, is 0.65 nanometer. So you can see that this criteria for having thin channels for dimensional scaling can be achieved by this type of materials. So does this solve all these problems? But unfortunately, the answer is no. This does not really solve the power supply voltage scalability, though it kind of solves the dimensional scalability. And the reason there is because there is a fundamental limitation when you talk about power supply voltage scalability. And the reason is that when you supply a gate voltage, for example, say VGS, the maximum amount by which you can reduce the barrier is also VGS. And since the electrons in the source are kind of distributed according to Boltzmann equation, which means the number of electrons reduces exponentially as you go higher in energy, we can calculate that the current will increase following exponential VGS by KT. So K is here the Boltzmann constant and T is the temperature. And if you calculate from here the slope and at room temperature, it will give you 60 millivolts, which means you need at least 60 millivolt of voltage to increase the current by tenfold. So that's the fundamental limitation of subthreshold swing that comes from the thermal distribution of electrons. So what does this mean for device performance? So suppose you want to have a current on-off ratio of 10,000, which is 10 to the power 4. That means you need at least 4 into 60 millivolts, which is 240 millivolts of supply voltage to get that current on-off ratio. You cannot apply a lower voltage to get that current ratio if you want. And that's in the case of perfect electrostatics. That is, if you apply VGS voltage, the barrier also goes down by that amount. But normally, it would be even worse. So it would look more like that red curve where subthreshold swing will be greater than 60, which means you would end up requiring much more supply voltage to get that current on-off ratio. So if we really want to reduce the supply voltage, we have to kind of think beyond this. We have to do something so that we can overcome this thermal distribution of electrons effect. And if we can get a subthreshold swing which is less than 60, which is shown by the blue curve, then you can have lower voltage. You can apply lower voltage and still have the same current on-off ratio. So that means just having good electrostatics is not enough. So we are bound by this thermal distribution of electrons because in conventional transistors, the transistors that we have in our laptops or mobile phones, the electrons jump over an energy barrier. So can you really think of some different carrier transport mechanism? So instead of making the electrons jump over the energy barrier, why not just make it kind of go through the barrier like a ghost walking through the wall? And the scientific name for which is quantum mechanical tunneling. So however, there are challenges in having this effect and make it efficiently work in a device. So suppose there is this guy here who loves low energy and thinks that he's just going to go through the wall and go to the other side, right? But by the time he goes to the other side of the wall, can you imagine how it looked like? It would look something like this. And this is because the electron waves will decay exponentially as it passes through the energy barrier. So that leads to very low current when you talk about, you know, quantum mechanical tunneling effect. So if we really want to develop very efficient devices out of this effect, that means we have to reduce the barrier width. We also have to reduce the barrier height at the same time, and which also means there are very intricate device design constraints in developing this device. We need to have lower barrier width, lower barrier height. We have to have high electric field at that tunneling junction. So getting all this together has turned out to be very difficult and challenging. Moreover, note that having a steep characteristics, and I call here subthermal subthreshold swing because steeper than 60 means you have to overcome this thermal effect. So having this steep subthreshold swing, subthermal subthreshold swing over a small region is not good enough. That will not help to reduce the supply voltage. We'll have to have this subthermal subthreshold swing over a large range of current if we really want to have smaller supply voltages. And according to the ITRS, which is this International Technology Roadmap for Semiconductors, we need this steep characteristics over 4 decades of current to this for this device to be effective, but which has turned out to be very difficult to achieve previously. So I will discuss next how we can overcome this barrier. So this is a device that I developed during my PhD work. It's called the ATLAS TFET and stands for atomically thin and layer semiconducting channel, tunnel field effect transistor. So I will discuss how this device works and how we get all those characteristics that we want, that is smaller barrier height, that is thinner barrier height, thinner barrier, smaller barrier height, and also high electric field. So this device that I developed, so it had a 3D material as the source. So the 3D material is shown by the green region here. So by using 3D material, I could basically tap into the mature doping technology of 3D materials. So doping basically means we bring in foreign atoms. It's not a pristine material. You can dope it with foreign atoms, and then you can basically give that material other characteristics which the intrinsic material does not have. And in this case, doping is trying kind of making this material very highly conductive. And what that helps is helps in increasing the electric field at the tunneling junction. Note that the channel is still two-dimensional material. So I have used a heterostructure, 3D source, 2D channel. So I can still leverage the improved electrostatics, which I said that thinner channel helps in dimensional scaling. So the channel here is still two-dimensional, so that with the dimensional scaling, you're still retaining that property. Moreover, this heterojunction, that's 3D versus 2D on top of 3D, this is van der Waals in nature, which means there is no covalent bonding between this 3D and 2D materials, which means even though I doped the 3D material very highly with foreign atoms, these atoms cannot just go very easily to the 2D material. So that means we have a very steep doping profile. So very high doping in the source, very less doping in the 2D material. So that creates a very high electric field at the junction between these two materials. And so that's the electric field. And then we also have to reduce the barrier height. And for that, you can choose the materials in such a way that you can reduce the barrier height. And how it works is if you know about the concept of band diagrams and all, so you basically have to choose a material which has a relatively low electron affinity and another material which has a relatively high electron affinity. So the barrier height here is what is shown by that red arrow. So you can choose mix and match materials so that you can tune the barrier height to your satisfaction. So in this case, I used germanium as a 3D material which has an electron affinity of 4 eV and molybdenum disulfide, which has 4.25 eV. So that gives a relatively low band gap overlap or the barrier height at the junction. So this is not the most optimal case. I use these materials also depending on what was available easily at that time. So this can be optimized further. You can still optimize these two materials for even better performance in future. And also, we reduce the barrier width. So to understand how the barrier width is smaller in this structure, let's see what's the mechanism of this device, how it works. So again, there are lots of band diagrams and all. So maybe the electrical engineering people will understand this more. So I'll try to make this very simple. This is basically an energy landscape, and this is drawn along the z-axis. So basically it starts with the germanium source, goes through the two layers of molybdenum disulfide and get dielectric, and then the gate. So the green region here is the germanium. So this one is in the off state, and this one is in the on state. So let's focus on the off state first. The green region is germanium. The yellow regions are the two layers of molybdenum disulfide. Then there's this gate dielectric, which is in blue. And then there's a gate, okay? So in the off state, what happens is that the energy landscape is such that the filled states in germanium, they do not align with the empty states of molybdenum disulfide. So that's shown by this black arrow and the cross mark. So the empty states of molybdenum disulfide is above with that yellow region. And the filled states of germanium is where those electrons, red electrons, are there. So you can see they are not aligning. However, when you want to turn on the device, what I do is I apply a gate voltage. So what I do then is bend the bands so that now you can see with the green arrow that the filled regions in germanium are now aligned with the empty regions in molybdenum disulfide. So current can now flow. So here you can see that the width of the barrier through which the electrons have to tunnel are kind of given by these two layers of molybdenum disulfide, right? And each layer is around three atoms thick. So the total channel thickness through which the electrons have to tunnel is around six atoms thick. So you can make this barrier atomically thin with this design. So we can achieve ultra-thin barrier with this process. And this just shows a TEM image. So the germanium, and it shows the two layers of molybdenum disulfide. So this device was also not ideal because when you have germanium, and we also have a region of germanium oxide we found. So later on, for future research, it would be interesting to actually get rid of this germanium oxide because this is adding an extra layer of barrier, right? So you can even, there are opportunities for improving this device further in future by passivating the germanium surface. And this shows the subthreshold swing characteristics here. So the red line marks the fundamental limitation that comes from the thermal distribution of electrons. So it's at 60 millivolt per decade. And the blue squares that you see, that's for a conventional transistor. So I'm calling it a FET because it's a filled effect transistor, because you kind of modulate the transistor because from the field, electric fields from the gate. That's why it's called a filled effect transistor. So in a conventional field effect transistor, basically any transistor that goes in our computer laptops today, you can see that the subthreshold swing is always above that red line, which is those blue squares. However, for the Atlas TFET, you can see it can overcome that fundamental limitation and can give subthreshold swing, which is below that red line. And moreover, so this is basically showing the height of two layers of molybdenum disulfide, which is only 1.3 nanometer thick. And as I mentioned, that thinner the channel, you can also make it smaller. So this device not only leads to dimensional scalability that way, because it can have lower subthreshold swing, you can apply low voltage to get high change in current. It can also reduce power. So during my PhD, while I was working on these low-power electronic devices, I also got interested in other non-electronic computational system, especially the brain, because brain probably can be thought of as the lowest power computer. So the human brain, which is this amazingly complex organ and the boss of our body, so the brain, it just weighs 3 pounds, but it's really the brain what makes us what we are today. And if we are to peep inside the brain, look in like super resolution, or take a close look at the brain, we'll see that it's, okay, the video is not running, but it's fine. So you'll see that it's formed of billions of computational elements, which are called neurons, which basically talk to each other using electrical and chemical signals. So the brain does all its computation, but consumes only about 20 watts of power, which is like similar to a mere light bulb. However, at present, we have very little knowledge as to how the brain works at all. I mean, how the brain function is still a mystery, and I would consider it one of the major challenges of today's scientific community. So why is it so difficult to understand the brain? So the electronic circuits, we develop them ourselves. We know all the interconnections between different components. And not only do we know the interconnections, we also know the individual components, how what it is made of, what material is it made of. We can draw the band diagrams. We know metal semiconductor and dielectrics. We know the physics of how it works, the individual components as well as the connections between those components. However, Mother Nature has developed this brain, and which is so complex, so intricate, that we human beings have not been able to decipher them yet. We don't understand the connections in details, that's one. We don't also understand the individual components and working mechanism of the components. We cannot draw band diagrams yet as to how these components work. And if we really take a close look at a very small region in the brain, we'll see that it's formed of like very compact jungle of biomolecules, which will probably look like a gum wall in Seattle. So if we really want to decipher this dense jungle, know how these individual components are arranged, we need some super resolution technologies. However, present super resolution technologies are either very expensive or very hard to use, requires expert handling. In most cases, it's both together. So in this respect, a technology called expansion microscopy is very interesting. So the idea behind expansion microscopy is that instead of using complicated, expensive hardware to look closely at a sample, why not expand the sample itself? So if there are two points very close together, cannot be resolved by a conventional microscope, you physically expand them and separate them from each other so that they can be distinguished. And we do this by using this special but not so special gel. This is the gel which is used in diapers. This is basically a hydrogel, and that expands when you add water to it. So the mechanism is very simple. You take a piece of brain tissue, you embed them in this expandable hydrogel material, and you add water. And so the brain expands, separating out the biomolecules from each other. And so you can use now a conventional optical microscope and still get higher resolution. So in the first version of this method, we expanded about 4.5-fold. So if the diffraction limit of light, which is the limit of resolution of a conventional microscope, is 300 nanometer, and if the expansion factor is 4.5, so then still using that diffraction limited microscope, you get an effective resolution of 70 nanometer. Just to explain how this process works, so you start with a fixed specimen. So I often get the question that when you expand, how is it still alive? I mean, how is it functioning? So I want to stress that you are not working with alive tissues. So this is fixed tissues. Here we are only interested in looking at the structure and the nanoscale orientation of different components. And that's similar to EM. We cannot work, so electron microscopy also works on, say, fixed specimens. And most, actually, super resolution methods works on fixed specimen. And they have its own challenges. So having super resolution in live, I think, is a greater challenge. Right now, we are focusing on fixed specimens, but interested in only the structure. So we start with the fixed specimen, and we anchor any biomolecules of interest that we are interested in looking into. Those could be proteins, those could be RNA, this could be genome architecture. And then we form this swellable gel, and finally we add water. So this gel network will expand, and since we have attached these biomolecules to this gel, so it will separate out the biomolecules from each other. And we can do this process iteratively. So as I mentioned, that higher, basically you would divide the diffraction limit by expansion factor to get resolution. So higher expansion factor means improved resolution. So we wanted to do this process iteratively, which means after first round of expansion, which is this blue gel, you can embed them in another expandable polymer network, which is that brown gel. And what you do then is you can get rid of this blue gel and we have to kind of have a mechanism of transferring this biomolecular information from first to the second gel, and then the second gel is expanded again. So this is a process called iterative expansion microscopy, or IEXM. And looking more closely into how it works, so in this process, the biomolecule, which is that red circle here, we stain them with primary and secondary antibodies and connect it to the first gelling network using a DNA handle. And after the first expansion, however, we discarded all the biomolecules. Now the DNA is kind of acting as a proxy to hold the relative biomolecular location information. And then a complementary DNA strand, which is this green curve here, that is used to transfer that location information from the first blue gel to the, which is shown by this dashed line, the brown gel. And then you can cleave away the blue gel, and the information is basically transferred now to the second gel, and that's the green curve, that green DNA that is holding the biomolecular location information. And then you can continue to expand that. So there are some challenges. We developed this, but you also were aware of the challenges that this method has, because we are kind of discarding the original biomolecule here, which is that red circle, and DNA is kind of acting as a proxy for that biomolecular information. Ideally, we'd like to retain the original biomolecules in the gel, which helps us to do multiplexing and look at whatever we want to do after the gelling process. So that's one challenge. The second challenge is there is an inherent error in this process. So since we have to attach these antibodies to recognize this biomolecule, which is the red circle, and the size of this primary and secondary antibodies together is around 30 nanometers. So you get an inherent error of 30 nanometer with this process. And this is not just for IEXM, but for any other optical super resolution technique which requires antibody staining. They will always have this inherent 30 nanometer error. And so we would ideally want to get rid of this inherent error and get lower better resolution than 30 nanometer. And moreover, we have to always use this DNA conjugated antibodies. So these are not available off the shelf. So you have to kind of prepare them, custom built in your own lab. And moreover, in the process of gel cleavage, the RNA molecules were destroyed. So our aim is to develop a process where we can do protein, RNA, DNA together. So we can look at their connection and how they are interacting. So to overcome this challenge, we develop a process called iterative direct expansion microscopy. So this is direct because now the biomolecules were connected directly to the gel. We didn't have to use DNA. Moreover, we can retain these biomolecules over multiple rounds of expansion. So we can also directly bring in the antibodies after expansion process. So this is still not published, so I'm not going into the details of the mechanism, but I will show you some results. So the advantage is, of course, the biomolecules are retained. We can use off-the-shelf antibodies. Moreover, we can bring in the antibodies after the expansion is done, so that the effective size of the antibodies, which is now reduced by the expansion factor. So if it's 30 nanometer antibody size, after expansion, when you bring in the antibodies, the effective size is 30 nanometer by the expansion factor. And if you're going for 20-fold expansion, the effective size would be about 1.5 nanometer. So another advantage of this process is that it has an inherent decrowding effect. So the biomolecules basically occur in a crowded environment. So sometimes the antibodies do not have access. So suppose the antibody is trying to access that red molecule at the center, it's surrounded by many other biomolecules, so it cannot have access there. However, after expansion, that environment is decrowded. So the antibody can have now better access to that red biomolecule. And we have seen that some antibodies which did not work before expansion, specifically for very crowded environments like synapses, actually work after expansion is done. And so apart from the decrowding effect, this process is also compatible with RNA because we did not have to use the other harsh chemicals that we had to use for IEXM. And overall, this is a much more easier process. So we used this technology to look at stereotypical structures. So, and microtubules is one of them. So microtubules are actually platforms over which these motor proteins walk. So when I came to know this first, I was very amazed that there are actually proteins which are walking along microtubules in your cells. And the diameter of these microtubules is around 20 to 25 nanometer, which you cannot see using a conventional microscope. However, when you applied IDEXM and under the same conventional microscope, you can see the distinct peaks of the two walls of the microtubules. And you also looked at synaptic proteins using this technology. And so synapse is basically the structure through which one neuron basically talks to another neuron. And what you are seeing here, if we just focus on the bottom images, so this is an image of a single synapse before any expansion using a conventional optical microscope. And there are two proteins in red and green. One is from a presynaptic neuron, another is from a postsynaptic neuron, basically two neurons, two separate neurons. And you can see that before any expansion, they just look like overlapping blobs. But after you do the IDXM using the same diffraction-limited microscope, you can actually see the red and the green separately, and you can also see the synaptic cleft between these two proteins. So we wanted to investigate what kind of biological questions you can answer with this technology. And for that, we collaborated with Professor Thomas Blanford at University of Maryland. And so let me first discuss a little bit about the synaptic function here. So suppose there is a blue neuron and a green neuron, and the blue neuron wants to talk to the green neuron. What will happen then is that the potential inside that blue neuron will increase. And there are calcium channels, which is that yellow thing, and those are voltage gated. That means with increase in voltage, they open up. When the voltage is low, they are going to be closed. So when the voltage inside that blue neuron increases, this calcium channel opens up. It will let in the flow of calcium ions. And that leads to the fusion of the synaptic vesicles. So there is a mechanism within the cells that when the calcium ions attaches, that leads to the fusion of these vesicles, which contains neurotransmitters, and which are those magenta triangles there. So when the synaptic vesicle fuses, so these neurotransmitters will be released. And what they will do then is go through that synaptic cleft, which is basically the gap between the two neurons, go to the next neuron, which is this green one, attach to the receptor molecules there in the next neuron, and then that receptor opens up and then it lets in flow of other ions. So that way, the voltage increase in that blue neuron kind of leads to changes in the green neuron. So communication happens through the synapse in these two neurons. And we wanted to look at these three specific proteins in this case. So calcium channel, as I mentioned, that lets in the flow of calcium ions. PSG95 is a protein which acts as a receptor, acts as a scaffold for these receptor proteins. So they basically help in holding the receptors in place. And another protein, red, that is the rim, this dictates where the synaptic vesicle is going to fuse. So we wanted to look at these three proteins and see if there is some meaning how they are arranged or they are just randomly arranged together. So you applied IDEXM to the mouse brain cortex in this case. And what you're seeing here in red is a rim and in blue is a PSG95. We characterized the peak-to-peak distances between them and it turns out to be about like 60, 70 nanometer, which is actually what has been reported in literature previously. So we know that we are going in the right direction. Now the interesting part comes here. So what I found is that all these proteins, instead of being uniformly scattered in the synapse, they actually form nanoclusters. So within the synapse, there is a cluster, 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 like this. And what is even more interesting is that the clusters of RIM and clusters of PSG95 and calcium channel, they kind of occur, they're aligned to each other. So within the synapse, there's this cluster, and they're in two separate neurons, but one cluster of proteins is actually aligned with, within nanoscale precision with the cluster of other protein, but they are in two separate neurons, though, across the synapse that's happening. So that is very interesting. So why this happens is, yes, it's very amazing. So as I mentioned that this protein RIM, basically it dictates where this vesicle is going to fuse. And this protein PSG95, it basically acts as a scaffold for the receptors. The fact that this vesicle is going to fuse directly above where the receptors are clustered, that means it reduces the distance that these neurotransmitters have to travel, which are these magenta triangles. Because if the receptors and the PSG95 are randomly scattered, then the neurotransmitters have to travel longer distances to go and activate the other neuron. So the probability of them getting lost is higher. So this is very similar in concept, if you can think of it, about the quantum mechanical transistor. Here we are trying to reduce the barrier width by using these atomically thin materials so that the electrons can tunnel effectively. So very similar concept here. The distance between the vesicle fusion site and the receptors are reduced in this case. And as I also mentioned that calcium channels basically the calcium goes through the calcium channels and activates the fusion of this synaptic vesicle. The fact that calcium channels will be clustered near that vesicle fusion site, that means that also increases the probability of calcium ions going and activating this fusion process, because if they were farther away, the calcium will be diffused everywhere else and they will be lost. So this seems to be a nanoscale organization within the synaptic cleft and between two synapses, which I found was absolutely amazing. So we are also applying this technology. So this were all done in healthy mouse brains, but we are also applying this technology to look at neurological diseases. We're collaborating on that. Basically, we're looking at Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, and autism. So I'm not going to go into details of this. But then the question is, how much can we expand? So we can expand about 100-fold with this method right now. So you can see here, that's a 50-fold expanded cell body of a neuron. This is a 65 expanded dendrite. And this is a 100-fold expanded another cell body. So I talked about two completely different technologies and areas today. One is a transistor, which is for low power application, and second is technology which helps us to look at the building blocks of the brain with super resolution, and talked about the transsynaptic architecture. So what kind of things will my group do when I form it? So the idea would be to really fuse these two fields, and in fact fuse basically in a broad terms, engineering, applied physics, and biology together. So I named it nano-cybernetic biotech. So nano is basically you are dealing with extremely small dimensions, which is 10 to the power minus 9 nanometer, 10,000 times smaller than the width of our hair. Cybernetic, so cybernetic means the use of technology to control any systems. So here it could mean the use of new technologies and physics to either control the transistor that you are building for low power applications or control biology, modulate biology. And yeah, biotech, because I always think of research as an adventurous scientific journey, and I believe it is important to have fun, and you can only do good research when you are absolutely loving it. because there's no reason you can not go to industry, earn more money doing less work, and why you should be doing PhD or being a professor, yeah, with working much more, but if you don't really enjoy and love what you do. So there would be two major research directions in my group. So one would be to invent disruptive technologies for nanoelectronic computation, which will not have the biology aspect, but it would be focused towards energy efficient computing. And second direction would be to use new kinds of device physics and chemical engineering, mechanical engineering, and electrical engineering. To develop new kinds of life machine, new paradigm for life machine symbiosis. So what is new paradigm for life machine symbiosis? So let's look at what we have today and where we are now. So we have electrodes and devices which are used for in vitro applications like cultured cells, cultured tissues like that. We also have in vivo applications, and we have electrodes which are tethered with wires, and they have really very amazing results in brain-machine interfaces. But you would ideally want to get rid of wires coming out of the coming out of our head and get like really small devices, and would want them to be untethered, wireless. And there has been research in that direction also. However, right now the sizes of these devices are almost a million times larger than the size of the cells. So first of all, they basically do much more volume displacement. They're invasive. So when you put in the devices in brain or any part of the body, they are displacing our biological volume. And moreover, they cannot give single cell precision. So compared to, say, a building where all the bricks would be similar, our body is not really made of cells which are similar. There is like humongous amount of diversity. And it has been shown that stimulating even a single cell can change the behavior of a person. So we really want to understand at a single cell level, modulate at a single cell level if possible, and be as minimally invasive as possible. So that should be the goal. So can you really make electronic engineering system which is smaller than a cell or similar to the size of the cell? So there are severe constraints in this, not only dimensional scalability, but also the power constraints, the power that it would be needed. But it is possible, not by the conventional electronics, but if we think of new kinds of physics, new kinds of engineering ideas, it should be possible to overcome these issues. So that's going to be one of the goals of my lab, to develop nanocomputers which will be of the size of the cells, so they can sense the biological environment, and they could either store it locally or it could wirelessly transmit the information to a system outside the body. And it could be also possible for it to do some internal computation, so that depending on the analysis results, it could further modulate the biological environment, either through, say, electrical stimulation, chemical stimulation, or drug delivery. And though my aim for the short and middle term are to use these devices for therapeutic effects and also for answering basic fundamental questions in biology, my long-term goal is really to make new kinds of bioelectronic interfaces which can help us basically transcend our biological limitations. So a little bit about applicant information. So what kind of students and postdocs I'm looking at. So there's few specific areas where probably they could fit directly. Someone who has a strong fundamental in electromagnetism, antenna design, RFID, wireless sensing. Those and also other areas, electronic devices, MOSFETs, solid-state physics, electronic circuits, biomedical devices, wearable implants, prosthetics, of course, brain activity recording, brain stimulation fits in nicely. Anyone working with new materials, chemistry, polymer chemistry, drug delivery would also be included there. But I think what is more important than someone having background in the specific area for me is someone who is very enthusiastic and passionate, because I believe someone who has that passion and enthusiasm can excel in any fields. So doesn't matter if someone does not have background in those. It's not difficult to learn anything if someone wants to. So that's my email address. I think it's also there. And you can find more information about the group and specific projects in this website. So yeah, thank you very much.
Thank you so much. It was super interesting. I learned a lot in you personally. I'm still working with you. And we're going to get in Tita like right now. Like it's outside the door. We just didn't want to disrupt the presentation. And we can also start a Q&A. And you can moderate it yourself if you want.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. So, questions. Yeah, introduce yourself first. Yeah.
My name is Kliman. And I'm wondering how far away do you think, like, predicting what sort of sentences or thoughts people have, like how far away do you think that is, like doing it, you know, by like imaging the brain?
Yeah, I think we are making some progress, right? We have been able to say predict dreams. Someone is dreaming. Right now, where we are now, if an elephant is moving, a person dreams that we see kind of a cloud moving. So that's kind of because we do not have that precision to do a very precise measurement. So I think we are still far away from getting that kind of precision where we are going to be able to, like, say pixel by pixel what we like someone is dreaming or someone is thinking about. Right now we can do at a crude level, but there are still applications for that. So I think, yeah, I think we are at least 5 years away. But again, you know, you cannot really predict anything about the future. That's the same goes. One disruption happens, one disruptive technology comes up, and, you know, then you are done. Oh, thank you. Yeah, sure.
Maybe trying to start doing things with live specimens immediately. Do you have any specific ideas or projects?
Yeah. So actually, I'm not going to follow up much on the expansion microscopy project. So I think of it as a gateway for me to learn biology. My work in my future group would more be with live animals. So I'm doing some projects right now basically for delivering particles to brain, blood-brain barrier. So my devices would be mainly for brain activity recording. So it's going to be with live animals.
Are you looking for maybe degradable devices or permanent devices in the brain, or you're flexible to approaches?
Yeah, I think both have its own applications, right? Devices which you put inside the body and after some time, after it is done with what it is been put for, it degrades. Another one is you want to put devices which are like chronically recording something and doing activities. I think both, I'm open to both of them, because both have their own applications.
So do you have an idea on the targeting of the cells?
On the what thing?
Of targeting of specific cells?
Yeah, I think targeting of specific cells, I think, is an interesting area by itself. There has been a lot of research that has been going on. So there are some attributes for each cell because they express different kinds of proteins and also RNA and things like that. So you can leverage those properties. Basically, you can learn a lot from this field of drug delivery in that case, yeah. Yeah. Oh, I think I will get you first, yeah.
Thank you. Thank you for a nice talk. So your PhD project and your postdoc project was like completely different shift in fields. Was there any struggles that you had when you had that shift? And how did you overcome them, if there were any?
Yeah, I think there was a lot of challenges in the beginning because I just didn't simply understand what my lab mates were talking about because all this jargons, all this lingo just seemed difficult. But I think I learned a lot and it was, I think, more fun than I would say it was struggle because I was learning new fields. That was something which had always been very interesting for me. Yeah, initially, yeah, the progress would be very slow. Compared to if I were to do a postdoc in, say, nanoelectronics, I would have several papers by now. But I don't have any till now because it's a new field. The learning curve had been steep. But I think being like, there's the two things, right? Being innovative and being productive. I think the second one, being innovative is much more interesting, and you would love it when you learn something new. So, yeah.
So, have you, circuits, the transistors that you made, are they in production?
Oh, not really. So, right now we are kind of in a 10 nanometer, 7 nanometer technology node. And this transistor is more for like sub 5 nanometer futuristic devices. We still have to overcome a lot of challenges for this to be in production. Because specifically for transistors, as you can see, the whole industry has to change and there. So, and silicon kind of varieties, you'll still be using it till 7 nanometer. And only when you go for sub 5 nanometer, then this is kind of futuristic devices, because silicon won't be useful after sub 5 nanometer. So that's for the futuristic technology node. Yes. Yeah, so that's what we had to characterize a lot. So what I didn't go into much details of the process, basically, before that expansion occurs, we have to kind of homogenize the tissue, otherwise it breaks up. So that process we had to basically optimize a lot, because if it is too harsh, then it destroys the proteins, right? And if it is not, if it's not optimized, then what happens is that expansion is not isotropic in nature. So right now we have tried about hundreds of proteins. I've been working mostly with synapses, and it seems that the process we have is now optimized, and most of the antibodies which work before expansion also works after expansion. And in fact, some of the proteins which do not work before expansion are actually working after expansion because of this decrowding effect. But then there could be one protein that we have not tried, which is kind of effective. So we have to do like a much more extensive search there. But the idea is that we can always tune the parameters at homogenization, make it gentler.
Is there interest in down the line into biological chips?
Biological chips? So this are kind of, what do you mean by biological chips?
I guess I mean like
the biological computing? Or? So synthetic biology computing, like people making ANDAN or GAZE, those kind of things using biological circuits?
Yeah.
That's, yeah, probably right now I don't have plans to do that. Yeah, probably I don't have plans to do that, but who knows in future. Yeah, sure.
So I think I emailed you like 2 weeks ago.
Okay.
And I felt like your fangirl at that point, because I was super excited about what you're doing. So yeah, I was like so excited to read your papers. Anyway, so I have done some work in biology and computation work and a little bit in electrical engineering. So I think it's really cool that you're combining a lot of these areas. So do you see more of a focus in combining any of those fields more closely, or is it just any of those fields? Because I mean, it's so exciting that you could do a lot of different exploratory studies in a lot of ways, right? And so, that was just kind of, if you had a focus.
I think my group would be more biotechnology than pure biology. So the idea would be to develop technologies, so like using nanoelectronics or chemical engineering and stuff. It won't be like focused on pure biology. So the idea would be develop the technologies and then collaborate with biologists or neuroscientists who can help understand biological questions. And so yeah, one direction, as I said, would be pure nanoelectronics. And the other direction would be basically combination of engineering and biology. As of now, I'm not thinking of pure biology applications, because I think we need tools to understand biology right now. But once the tools are developed, probably I'm going to collaborate, because yeah, I don't consider myself a biologist. I don't have expertise. I would mainly focus on the technology part.
Okay.
Does that answer your question?
Yeah. Because I remember it said something about having clean lab or working in a clean room, right? And doing actual circuits building. And so I was very intrigued by the idea of doing, so you would change silicon, I would assume. That's one thing that has to happen. And then you're talking about the germanium layer, right? So you're saying you would change out the germanium and try to calculate the properties or see how much electrostatics versus other bonding is happening.
Yeah. So that would be kind of the pure, nanoelectronics part.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's what I was sort of wondering.
If we do not have any more questions, we're very grateful for everyone for coming today. Feel free to reach out to Davlina at this email, or we're going to also be posting the video of her presentation. We don't have to do notes because the video exists, but also all the information on the Zapians, all pages. And then if any of you want to join Zapians and further exploring other opportunities and meeting amazing people like Davlina, please email us at Zapians Officers. And thank you so much for coming.
Okay, thanks a lot, everyone.